a real life. So we are live.
आवाज नहीं आ रही है गुप्ता जी।
गुड मॉर्निंग, वेलकम एवरीवन। थैंक यू सो मच फॉर जॉइनिंग अस। एंड माय नेम इज प्रीति बंसल। आई एम द असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर इन अरावली कॉलेज ऑफ एडवांस्ड स्टडीज इन एजुकेशन। एंड टुडे इज द वेरी फर्स्ट डे ऑफ आवर 7 days faculty program on research method. This program is of 7 days only. But before starting the program, I would like to introduce our principal ma'am, Dr. Anshu Radha Agarwal, for a formal speech message. Over to you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, Preeti. Good morning, one and all. I'm Dr. Anshu Agarwal, the principal of the Arali College of Advanced Studies in Education. Very heartily welcome to all of you in this 7 days online faculty development program on the research methods. Aravali College of Advanced Studies in the Education is the part of the group of the Aravali Institution. It is a very small part of the Aravali Institution, but we always say that the small one is the best one. So I can say that our college is also the best out of the education colleges. It has been established in 2007, and almost 13 years has been completed with it relevance of the education. And we have B.Ed and M.Ed courses with the strength of 300 students. And we have a very qualified faculties also who are doing very hard to prepare the students as teachers. And I can say that this is also the recognized by the NCT, and it is affiliated with the Chaudhary Ranbir Singh University Jind. So we know that the faculty development program is very important part for all the teachers and the faculties nowadays, especially in this pandemic situations. So today we have eminent resource person, Dr. D.N. Sansanwal. So I hope that you all will enjoy this faculty program and you will learn a lot in the field of the research. So thank you so much, and once again, warm welcome to all of you in this faculty development program. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much for your words. Now I would like to introduce Professor S.K. Sinha sir, Dean Academics Affairs, Chaudhary Ranbir Singh University, Jind, as a chief guest for the inaugural session of our FJP. Over to you, sir. Thank you.
And firstly, I congratulate Aravali College of Advanced Studies ki he organized FDP on research methodology. FDP on research methodology. And I congratulate Mr. Adana ji, dynamic principal of this college, Anshu Agrawal ji, and all faculty members, participant, resource person, and I am thankful to Dr. Anshu Agrawal to invite as a chief guest. Basically, the research methodology is the very important part of my life in studies. Basically, in social science research, it's different in physical science research. हम जीवन में भी रिसर्च करते रहते हैं, रिसर्च होते रहता है, और उस रिसर्च से हम कहीं ना कहीं बहुत कुछ सीखते हैं. कई संभावनाएं हैं, कई लाइफ की जरूरतें हैं, हम सब कहीं ना कहीं शोध करते रहते हैं. रिसर्च हमारे दिनचर्या का एक रूप है. हम रोज एक रिसर्च करते हैं और फिर उस पर हम अमल करते हैं, फिर उस अनुभव को हम शेयर करते हैं. आई एम थैंकफुल टू ऑल द कॉलेज ऑर्गेनाइजेशन टू ऑर्गेनाइज ए सच ए टाइप ऑफ एफडीपी इज द वेरी यूजफुल फॉर ईच एंड एवरी पर्सन इन डेली लाइफ और इन प्रोफेशन, इन एजुकेशन, इन ऑल सेक्टर. थैंक यू वेरी मच.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for your words. Now I welcome our resource person of FTP, Dr. Dayanand Sansanwal sir, former HOD and Dean School of Education, Devi Ahilya Vishwavidyalay, Indore. He is expert of research and advanced statistics. He has done about 500 seminars and other events as a resource person. Welcome, sir. Welcome to our FTP program. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much. Good morning to everyone. D.N. Sansanwal, and this is my email address. If anyone like to ask a question, then you can send me on my email also. Say, we have already completed 7 days program. And in that program, we have already covered the definition of research, characteristics of research, types of research, and the steps which we follow in conducting the research. We have also covered completely the hypothesis, all aspects of the hypothesis, and all aspects of the sampling. Now, all of you must be knowing that the first step of research is identification of problem, but it is not the selection of problem, because there is a difference between identification and selection. Selection is a part of identification. Now, once you have selected a problem, then in that you have already selected your variable, you have written your title, and you have written your objective. This is the sequence in which a researcher moves. Now, once you have the objective, these objectives are nothing but the research questions. So research questions and objects can be used interchangeably. This is very important because there are a lot of confusion. So I had clarified all these things. Then the second step was the formulation of hypothesis. And I did say that formulation of hypothesis cannot be the step in all types of researches. The formulation of hypothesis will be the step only in those researches where researcher is able to collect the quantitative data, or if has collected the qualitative data, but that can be converted into quantitative, then and only then you should have a hypothesis. Otherwise, you cannot test the hypothesis. After that, the third step in some of the researches, and the third and second step in some of the researches is data collection. When you are collecting the data, then you know from where to collect the data. And when you start thinking about from where, means you are talking about your sample. You are talking about your sampling procedure. Now, once you have decided that you want to collect data from this particular group, the next question arises, how will you collect and with what, with the help of what? Once you say with the help of what, then it comes to tool or instruments. Normally, in medical sciences, in physical sciences or sciences, the researchers use instrument, and normally in social sciences and humanities, we use tools. But the purpose of tools as well as instrument remains the same. So both these will help the researcher in collecting the relevant information, in collecting the relevant data. Now, I will continue with this particular topic for another 2 days. So today is the first day of this 7 days series. So it is tools and instrument one. So it is the part one that I am trying to deal today. Now I will be talking about, first of all, the characteristics of the tool. Okay, this is important, because whatever the data that you will collect, this data will imbibe the characteristics of the tool which you have used. So if your tool is not fine, so your data will also not fine. Then I will tell the difference between measurement and assessment. Lot of people, they use these two words interchangeably. Please understand, you cannot use them interchangeably. You must understand both measurement as well as assessment. In science, mostly people use the word measurement. In medical science, they use measurement. In agriculture, they use measurement. In psychology and education, sometimes they use measurement. In physical education, they use measurement. Otherwise, it is the assessment that has to be used. You can't use these two words interchangeably. I will tell you the difference between the two. Then I will tell you the different types of tool, and there is a lot of confusion also with respect to the types of the tool. Please, I request you that when you read any book on research methodology, you have to read it very, very carefully, because sometimes the writers, they use a particular word which is not appropriate, and sometimes the reader gets that word and is not using that word later on while the person is expressing his own ideas. So sometimes those words which you are taking from the books may not be technically correct. So you cannot take the matter from the books as it existed. You have to think and then see whether it is correct or not. In my earlier lectures, I had pointed out a lot of information which is given in books, and that is technically incorrect. Okay, and now here also I will refer to some of the books whenever the situation arises. Then I will tell you that these tools, whatever you will be using, some of them are standardized and some of them can never be standardized. Please underline never. So they always remain unstandardized. And there are many tools which have been developed by the people and they can be used by other researchers also. Sometimes the researcher does not take the already developed tool that is available in the field, but he or she wants to develop his or her tool. Then exactly how that has to be developed. So I will tell you the procedure of development as well as standardization. So there are some tools which only can be developed, but they cannot be standardized. But there are some tools which can be developed and they can be standardized. And the procedure of standardization, science students, they know it, that they also have to standardize their own procedure. Without standardization, they cannot conduct the experiment and they cannot collect the data for their research. So this is the sequence of my presentation. I hope all of you are with me and you have noted down. Now, the characteristics. Then the characteristics of the data depend on the characteristics of the tool or the instrument. I have said, see, if there is a plate and if I put the food in that particular plate and if the plate is dirty, then my food will become dirty. So the characteristics of the plate has now been shifted to the food. The same way when I take a tool and if this tool is not reliable, so whatever the information I am collecting with the help of this tool, this information will not be reliable. This is important. When you take a weight and when you weigh the rice using this particular weight, if this weight is of 1 kg, then when you are measuring it, then rice also will be of 1 kg. But if the weight is not of 1 kg, it is less than 1 kg, then your rice will not be 1 kg, it will be less than 1 kg. Okay, so therefore, whatever the information you get with the help of the tool characteristics will shift to the information. This is important. When I am filling the form, so whatever is asked in the form, when I am giving the information, my information will depend upon what is asked. Whatever is asked is not okay. If it is vague, then I will also give vague information. I need not to explain it further. You have understood it. So the characteristics of the tool will become the characteristics of the data. So that is why it is very, very important to have appropriate tool. The desirable characteristics of all tools, irrespective of the discipline, whether you are in science or you are in social science, you should try to see that your tool must try to fulfill these characteristics, or your tool must have these characteristics. One of the characteristics is called a validity. You know, each tool is developed to measure, or each instrument is developed to measure and tool to assess. So tool or the instrument, they are to assess or measure what it is supposed to assess. Say if sometime you might have done in your life that when you go to the picture hall, these days it is not, but in the near picture, that picture hall, there is a machine, and sometime people used to take their weight. So once you insert a coin, then the ticket will come, and on that your weight will be written. But it comes along with a remark also that your face resembles Amitabh Bachchan. That means, do you think that particular machine, which is a weighing machine, how can that machine can compare the faces of the two people? So therefore, this machine is not valid for comparison of the faces, but it is valid for the measuring the weight of the person. Now, when you take thermometer can measure the temperature, etc., etc. So each tool is developed to assess a particular characteristics. Now, when you develop a test in, say, psychology, say it is social psychology, so you will have questions related to the different aspect of the social psychology. And if this particular tool contains question related to the social psychology, then yes, it is a valid one. So validity means if this tool can assess accurately as it is purposed to assess. Next is a reliability. Reliability refers to the consistency. You know, there are people, they keep on giving some information. At some time they give some information, at some time they give some other information. So their own information get contradicted. So the person is not reliable. He is not giving the information on which you can have a faith. So reliability means you should have a faith. Now understand, there is a watch. It is 10 minutes ahead. Now every day it will give you the time, which is not the exact time at that point, but it gives you 10 minutes ahead. So there is a consistency in the watch, but it does not give the true time. Therefore, it is not valid. So that means a tool may be a reliable tool, but may not be a valid tool. But if a tool is valid, it has to be reliable. These characteristics I will further reinforce when I come to. Next is the objectivity. All of you know the objective type questions and essay type questions. In essay type questions, when the teacher checks And if the student has written the answer, keeping in mind the question, it is very difficult for a teacher to give him 0 marks, because some portion of the answer written by the student might be correct. But if it is an objective type question and answer, whatever the answer you give, your answer may be either correct or wrong. In objective type, we cannot say that the answer is partly correct or partly wrong, or partially correct or partially wrong. No, this cannot be done. So the objectivity, so that means whatever the tool either measures or assesses, it assesses objectively without any personal bias. Another is sensitivity. You know, this particular word, whenever there is a change in the season, some of the people are so sensitive that with the change in the season, either they will have a bad throat, or they will have sneezing, or they will have this, or they will have that. It's because they are very sensitive. Sometime when you see the movie, sometime the movie is such that you are attached and the tears starts coming from your eyes. You are sensitive at that point. So sensitivity means when there is a slight change, and if that instrument or tool can assess that slight change, then the instrument is said to be sensitive. The sensitivity of the instrument is very important in science. It's very important in medical science, in pharmacy, in agriculture, etc., etc. But the tools which are used either in psychology or in management or in education, etc., they are not sensitive at all. So sensitivity will not be the characteristic of the tool, but it will be a very important characteristics of the instrument. And let me tell you here, more sensitive the instrument is, more costly it will be. The cost and its sensitivity are directly related. More costly, more sensitive, more sensitive, more cost. So this sensitivity will be a very important characteristics in science, in medical science, in pharmacy, in engineering, etc., etc., but not in social science to that extent. The last characteristics is the usability or the practicability. See, any tool you have, for that particular tool, you always have a manual. If you purchase a car, then along with the car, there is a small manual, it comes. And if the person reads that manual and then uses the car, he will be in a better position to use it. Similarly, when you purchase a fridge, along with fridge also, there is a small booklet. And some of the information about the fridge are given in that small booklet. And if you read it, and as it is given in this booklet, if you follow all those points, then your fridge will last long. Similarly, in psychology, there are tools, and for every tool, there will be a manual. And in the manual, it will be given how exactly this tool must be administered, how the scoring is to be done, what is the age group for which you can use it, what is the reliability, what is the validity, what is the norms which you use to interpret, etc., etc. So the tool which you will be using in your research will determine the quality of your finding. So the quality of the finding depends to a large extent on the tool's characteristics. I'm sure you are getting me. Now the first characteristics, as I said, was validity. And I have already explained you that validity refers to the extent to which a tool or instrument measures what it is supposed to measure or assess. So if a tool you are developing is a reasoning test, then this particular test, to what extent it can assess the reasoning. This is important. In psychology, you cannot have the only one tool of assessing reasoning, because reasoning can be defined in different ways. And therefore, depending upon your definition, you can develop the tool. But in science, when you have a tool, which is instrument, you have an instrument, say the thermometer. Now, thermometer can only measure the temperature. So therefore, in science, it is very different. There you will have thermometer. That is a different issue. Whether it is degree or Fahrenheit, that's a different issue. But thermometer is a thermometer. In social sciences, you do not have this, because each variable can have multiple definitions. When you say self-confidence, I can define self-confidence in my own way. You can define self-confidence in your own way. So therefore, when you are defining the self-confidence on the basis of this definition, whatever tool you will develop, this tool only can assess that portion of the self-confidence which is expressed in your definition. So this is very, very important thing. Now, this I have said, that in science and medical science, etc., the instrument, of course, their validity is a higher degree, but in social sciences, it's not. This also I have said that social science variables are very, very complex variable. So it's very difficult to have only one definition of a particular variable, say anxiety, stress, reasoning, frustration, job satisfaction, reaction towards ETV program, etc., etc. All these variables are complex variables because they have so much to include in that. And one particular tool you cannot have where everything is included. So the tool in research must be valid. The tool which you are using, if it is not valid, then you really will not be able to say whatever you want to say on the basis of the findings. But understand, there are many tools about which you are not very sure about the reliability. about the validity. So you do not know the validity. That I will come little later when I come to the those tools which cannot be standardized. Next characteristics is a reliability. You know, reliability means consistency. That if you take one particular tool and you try to use it n number of times, then will it give you the same result or it will give you the different result at different point of time? Again, it depends upon the time gap that you are having and the variable that you are trying to assess. Say, for example, if I take my weight today and if I take my weight tomorrow and day after tomorrow, using the same machine, I am sure my weight cannot change within 2-3 days. When I take a test of reasoning today, and if I take the same test tomorrow to the group without telling that tomorrow also I will assess, you will find that their scores will almost remain the same. So that's the meaning of consistency. But as I have said, that consistency does not ensure validity. So the reliability cannot ensure the validity. But if a tool is valid, then it has to be reliable. This is important. So reliability cannot guarantee the validity, but validity does guarantee the reliability. This is important. This weight example I have given, that's fine, nice. Now, let us take another example. Suppose a watch is 10 minutes ahead and every day you find it is 10 minutes ahead. So there is a consistency. That means it is reliable. But it is not valid because it does not give the correct time. At home, many of the people, they have a watch which they keep it 5 minutes ahead or 10 minutes ahead. I wonder why people do that. Because they already know that their watch is 10 minutes ahead. If it is so, then why people keep their watch 10 minutes ahead? Maybe it's a psychology. Some psychological effect might be there. Oh, yes, there is still time, like that. So please think about it. So this I have said, the tool may be reliable, but it will not be valid. On the other hand, if a tool is valid, it has to be reliable. This I have explained to you. So therefore, validity ensures reliability, but reliability does not ensure the validity. That means a tool might be reliable, but is not valid. But whenever a tool is valid, it has to be reliable. Now, another characteristics is objectivity. And you know the meaning of objectivity, which is free from bias, personal bias. I think I should not say, but I can tell you. See, as an examiner in tests, the teacher, he knows each and every student, and the student name is also there. When I check the answer of a particular student, if that student is close to me, then I'm likely to give little bit more marks. That means I am not objective at that point of time. Now, you know many a times that the objective, your essay type questions, the objectivity of essay type question is very, very, very low. But the objectivity of objective type question is very high. What does it mean? If I take one particular question and the answer written by one student, and if I photocopy it, I make 5 photocopies and I give these 5 photocopies to 5 different teachers of the same subject. And I request them to evaluate it. And after evaluation, when I try to compare, you will find they will not give the same marks out of 10. Somebody may give 5 marks, someone may give 7 marks, someone may give 3 marks. So that means because of objectivity is lacking. But instead of the essay type, if it would have been an objective type question, and if the answer sheet I photocopy and give it to the 5 teachers, everybody will either give 1 marks or give 0. If the correct answer carries 1 marks, the answer is correct, everyone will give 1. If the answer is wrong, everyone will give 0. So therefore, the objective type of questions, their objectivity is more, and it is because of this, all question papers which are set in the competitive examination, like UGC, they have their exams. Like CAT, they also have their exams. Like UPSC, they have one paper, which is the first paper, and it is objective type paper. The second paper, which they call it mains, is not objective type, but it is essay type. All right. So therefore, this is what is more important. So in research, when you want to collect the data, your data should be such that people can have faith on it. So it has to be reliable, it has to be valid, and it has to be objective. There should be no personal bias, there should be no personal, any characteristic should not play a role. This I have said, essay type questions paper, I have said that subjectivity in assessing the answers, because essay type, that's there. And so less objective, but more subjectivity in assessment of the essay type question, that's fine, this I have said. Now, the multiple choice type, the items which all of you know, that they are very, very objective. Now, a new type of question I have developed, one of them is multiple discriminatory type item. And in this, let me tell you, if you do not know, you cannot answer, or your answer will not be correct. If you answer, your answer will be wrong. They say multiple discriminatory type item. There I have 3 questions or 4 questions. And for then I have 25 or 30 alternatives. In multiple choice type of question, the guessing might be, if you have 4, the guessing is 25%. If you have five choices, the guessing is 20%. But in multiple choice item, the guessing cannot be further reduced to 20%. This question was in my mind, and I started thinking, and I developed a question where the guessing was reduced. If I have three questions and I have 30 alternatives, for one question, out of 30, only one is correct. So the guessing is 1 by 30. Now, the 29 options remain. For the second question, out of 29, only one is correct. So the guessing is 1 by 29. And for the third one, it will be 1 by 28. Now you see here, guessing is substantially reduced. There is another type of question which recently I have developed. I call it a multiple answers type question. There is one question and there is not one correct answer. There are more than one correct answer. And the two questions I did try it out online, and I collected data from all over India, and I am giving you the responses and the result of those people who were assistant professor, associate professor, professors, head and dean. There were people of 376 or 77. 8.37% of the people could give me the correct answer. Understand, that is the strength of multiple answers type question. Some of you will get the questions after my lecture and try to answer, and you will come across that sometime in one particular question, you have more than one correct answer. So the multiple choice type of question, and therefore in multiple here scoring is very objective, and objectivity is the most primary prerequisite required for maintaining all qualities of good tool. This is important. So the tool which you use in the research must be objective. Now the sensitivity means if there is a slight change in the characteristics that is being measured or assessed with the help of tool or the instrument, whether that tool or instrument can record the smallest change. Say, for example, if there is a slight change in your understanding of research method, and if I give you a test, will that test help me to find out the small change that has taken place by virtue of this particular webinar? The answer is no. But if you take a weight, and if there is a slight change in your weight, either it has gone up or it has come down, your weighing machine can help you to find out that. And now there are digital weighing machines, so therefore it's possible. If there is a slight change in your body temperature, then the thermometer will help you to find out that small change. So now each instrument which people in science subject they use, each instrument can measure the smallest characteristics which is for which it is developed. Whatever is the smallest which it can weigh, that is what is called the sensitivity of that particular tool. or you can say accuracy of that particular tool. Now, if you take a watch, the smallest time that you can record with the help of a watch is 1 second. So this watch is sensitive to the extent of 1 second. But now there are digital watches where you can record the time in fraction of seconds. So this watch is more sensitive in comparison to the other watches where you can only take the reading up to 1 second, but here you can take up to fraction of second. So sensitivity, this how it moves with the tool. This I have said that if a person takes his weight using a weighing machine before taking lunch and he takes again and he again takes his weight with the help of the same machine after taking lunch. So whatever the change, will your machine be able to record that small change? If you take your weight, then take your breakfast and then take your weight. So do you think this machine will be able to record the small change in your weight? If the answer is yes, then the machine is sensitive. If the answer is no, the machine is not sensitive. Okay, so sensitivity is an important characteristic of instrument in science, in medical science, in pharmacy, in engineering, etc., etc. And that is why the instruments which are being used in laboratories or in clinics are very costly. Some of them cost up to 1 crore and maybe more than that. Now, the least count of the instrument refers to the sensitivity, the least, the smallest measurement that your instrument can give you is the sensitivity. And this characteristics is absent as far as the tool is concerned. When you have a reasoning test, when you have a self-confidence scale, okay, such type of tools will not have any, you have your interest inventory, vocational interest inventory. So the sensitivity characteristics will not be of the tool, but it has to be of instrument. So the sensitivity word will not be used by people who are from science or from languages, but yes, sensitivity word can be used by people from science and pharmacy, medical, etc., etc. Now, the last characteristic of the tool is usability. That how exactly a tool has to be used. A tool is useless unless it is not usable. If it is not usable, it is useless. But if it is usable, it's very, very helpful. And you know that there are many instruments. If you want to use it, you have to undergo a training. But there are many instruments, for example, thermometer. The training is not a rigorous training. There is no need of any training, except you have to say that whether you have to see the upper curve or you have to see the lower curve in the temperature. That's all. Otherwise, it's very easy. So this I have said, that suppose in order to ensure comprehensiveness, it was felt that 1,000 items should be given to answer in 10 hours. Do you think a tool having so many items will be useful? I'm sure you will say no. Then what? Then it means the number of items must be such that you are able to use on your target group, on your population, whatever is there. So therefore, this particular tool having thousands of items and you have given 10 hours to answer it, it may be valid, but it is not usable because it is very difficult to use it. So a tool has to be such that you are able to use it. So it has to be practicable so that the researcher is able to use it. So that is why all tools which are available in social sciences, they are not very lengthy. If your tool is too lengthy, then understand it will not be easy to use it. I have seen sometime some people have a tool which runs into 30 pages, 40 pages. Now, if you send that tool to me, looking at the number of the page, I will lose all my interest in answering the whatever, in giving the response to the items which are there in that particular one. So therefore, it is important that the length of the tool must be such so that the your target group, they are able to give their responses. So that is the one. So usability. And in that usability, dear friends, everything is given in manual. So that is why for each and every instrument and for each and every tool, there is a manual, or one has to undergo a special training, okay, in using that particular tool. So this is very important. Now, as I said, you cannot use measurement and assessment word interchangeably. Both these words, they do not give the same meaning. They are different. So let us try to understand the difference between measurement and assessment. And dear friends, many books on research methodology or many books on evaluation, they do not differentiate between measurement and assessment. Why they do not differentiate, I don't understand, but as far as me is concerned, I do find they are different, and now I'm giving you the difference. Measurement and assessment cannot be used interchangeably, that I have said. For example, weight, height, temperature, and speed. They are always measured. They are never assessed. So measurement gives you the complete information of that variable at that point of time. When you are driving on the road, you can see the speed of your car, and that will give you the complete information about the speed at that point of time. That is measurement. Okay? And it cannot be called assessment. Achievement in mathematics or vocabulary and reading comprehension, it can never give you the complete information. It will always give you a part information. Part information of the whole. So therefore, this is what exactly is assessment. You cannot call it measurement. Because measurement you will use only for those variables instrument. If instrument gives the complete information of that variable at that point of time, then it is measurement. If that tool does not give the complete information of that variable at that point of time, is called assessment. Say, I can never find out the complete understanding of any student related to any subject. It's not possible. So that is why we use their assessment, we don't use their measurement. In science, in medical science, we use measurement because they are able to give the complete information about that particular object at that point of time. So I have said measurement gives the complete information, whereas assessment gives the partial information. You cannot find out the complete vocabulary of any person. You cannot find out the complete self-confidence of a person. You cannot find out the complete personality of a person. So all these variables, they belong to the psychology and human psychology, etc. So these all can never be measured, but they can be assessed. Now, another difference. Measurement is always quantitative in nature. But your assessment can be quantitative as well as qualitative. For example, if you ask someone the problems people had during COVID-19 period or during lockdown period, people will give different problems and they will express in words. So it's a qualitative. Okay? If you administer a test and then you do the scoring, you have achievement score of that particular person in that particular subject. That is assessment because it is not giving the complete information of that person in that subject. So therefore, your assessment can be qualitative as well as quantitative, but measurement is always quantitative. Measurement is in science, engineering, I have said. Assessment is in languages, history, political science, education, psychology, social work, whatever subject you have, other than science, it's all assessment. Now, I'll go to the next point, and that is the types of the tool. Please see here, now I will not talk about instrument. I will talk about tool because instruments are in science and there are so many instruments in science. I need not to talk about that. But I will talk about the tools. The type of the tools are, they are basically of two. One is called standardized tool. Another is called unstandardized. See, the question papers which were there in your annual examination or in my annual examination, either in the school or board examination or university examination, all those tests which we have passed, including me, they were unstandardized. Okay? So therefore, I am the product of unstandardized tool. Understand, this is a very, very important thing. And you know the difference between standardized and unstandardized. Okay, so therefore your unstandardized tool, the reliability, you don't know the validity, you don't know, but standardized you know. So therefore these are the two tools and two categories or two classes in which different tools we can classify. Your standardized tools include tests. There are all types of tests, scales, all different types of scales. Please do not get confused with scales of measurement. The scales of measurement are different. They are nominal scale, ordinal scale, interval scale, and ratio scale. So I'm not talking of that. I'm here talking of attitude scales or reaction scales or opinion air. And then these are inventory or inventories. All these can be standardized and all these can be used as unstandardized. As I was saying, I am the product of unstandardized test. Because whatever test paper which came into the university exam or board exam or school exam, they were not standardized at all. So the tests, you can use them as standardized and you can also use them as unstandardized. The scale can be used as standardized and unstandardized, and in the same way the inventory. In research, as far as possible, if the tool can be standardized, the researcher must standardize the tool and then use it for collecting the data. You should not use a tool which is not standardized. If your tool is not standardized, then you do not know about the reliability, about the validity. And if it is so, then whatever will be the finding on the basis of the data which you are collecting with the help of such a tool, people will not have faith on the finding. So remember that although you have a tool which is not standardized, but you can standardize, so first standardize it and then use it. Researcher can also develop one's own tool. If you are developing a test or if you are developing a scale or if you are developing an inventory, then you must standardize it before you use it for collecting the data. But there are some tools which can never be standardized. It is not possible to standardize some of the tools. And these are the observation schedule, interview schedule, and questionnaire. You can never, never, never standardize them. Why? Because for standardization, you will require quantitative data. And because the unstandardized tool, your observation schedule, your interview schedule, and your questionnaire will give you the qualitative information more than the quantitative. So since the tool will give you the qualitative information and therefore you cannot standardize it because you cannot calculate validity and reliability. So, dear friends, in many of the subjects, people use questionnaire. Now, the questionnaire can be used as a general term, and it can also be used as a technical term. The test can be used as a general term, and it can be used as a technical term. My humble request to all the participants is that whenever you are conducting research, in research, you use questionnaire not as a general word, but it has to be used as a technical word. Similarly, the test should not be used as a general word, but it must be used as a technical word. So therefore, the test, the questionnaire, you must use them as a technical word. You should not use them as a general word. Although there are many tools which are available, and each tool has a name. And some of the tools, say for example, 16PF questionnaire. PF means personality factor. So 16 personality factor questionnaire. Actually, it's not a questionnaire. It is a scale. But in the name, the questionnaire has come. So like this, you will find that some of the tools, they will have a name which may have the word which is not a technical word. But it's always better to use the technical word because it will help in decreasing the confusion. It will not add to the confusion. It will add to the clarity. So these are the different tools, and we will try to understand if I have to develop a tool and I have to standardize also, then how exactly development and standardization should be done. If I'm not able to standardize, but I have to develop, then how exactly it has to be developed. Say your observation schedule, you can develop. Interview schedule, you can develop. Questionnaire, you can develop, but cannot standardize. Now, you know that in case of a test, you can say that the response of the person, whether it is a correct response or it is not a correct response. But in the scale, you cannot say whether the response is correct or incorrect. Because in scales and inventories, there is no standard response. But in case of a test, there is always a standard response. So this is how you can differentiate between the test and the scale, test and the inventories. And this is a very important information I am giving. You will not get this information from the book. And I do not know whether your teacher has ever given this information, but it's very important. The test and questionnaire are technical words, and they should not be used as a general word. Just now I have said that sometime they have used test and questionnaire as a general word, but we should not. We should use it as a technical word. Now, there are different tests which are available, and you know that there are different vendors and there are different catalogs and there are different pamphlets where you get all this information. So different tests are, for example, there is a test, there is a differential aptitude test, there is a vocabulary test, there is a reading comprehension test, achievement in physics test, reasoning test, etc., etc. There are many variables for which you can develop a test, and then later on you can standardize also. Or some of the standardized tools are already available. Say, for example, intelligence test. There are many, say, Patel's intelligent test. Okay, say Raven's progress, Raven's standard progressive matrices. Okay, these are some of the names. So you can develop, standardize, or you can take which have already been standardized. So these are some of the variables related to which you cannot have a scale. You cannot have a reasoning scale. It has to be a test, because the response can be categorized as correct or incorrect. Now let us see some example of scales. The scientific attitude scale, reaction towards educational television program scale, reaction towards program learning scale, self-confidence scale, etc., etc. And here, whatever the response which the person gives, you cannot say whether this response is correct or incorrect, because there is never a standard response. Let us see some inventories. One is interest inventory, odor preference record. Just see here it is written odor preference record, but it basically an inventory. Vocational interest inventory, food inventory, physical laboratory physics laboratory inventory. When you say in the lab, you know, there is a stock register, and in that stock register you have the inventory of all instruments which are available in the physics lab. In chemistry lab also, there are some instruments available, some chemicals available. So you have a list, and that is the inventory. So there can be chemical store inventory, etc., etc. These are the inventories which you can use in your subjects. Okay? All right. Now the difference between standardized and unstandardized tool. Your standardized tool, it is difficult to prepare, very difficult. But unstandardized tools, easy to prepare, not very difficult. The standardized tool will take more time in its preparation, in its development. But unstandardized tools, less time in its preparation. Okay. The costly. The standardized tools are more costly, and unstandardized tools are less costly. The standardized tools are more useful, and unstandardized tools are less useful. Your standardized tools are more objective, and unstandardized tools are less objective. In the for standardized tools, the reliability is known, and for unstandardized tools, reliability is unknown. For standardized tools, validity is known, and for unstandardized tools, validity is unknown. And the last point is, for standardized tools, norms can be developed, but for unstandardized tools, norms cannot be developed. Because for developing norms, you must have the quantitative data. And in unstandardized tools, you will have the qualitative data. So this qualitative data cannot be converted into quantitative. Hence, you cannot develop the norms, so you cannot establish the norms. Now, these are the differences between the standardized tools and the unstandardized tools. I hope the participants are with me. Now, the development and standardization of tool. Please see, I have said there may be a tool which has already been standardized. And if it has standardized, means it has been developed. Without development, you cannot standardize it. But there may be a tool which, as a researcher, you may like to develop. And after development, you will like to standardize it. So therefore, it will have the process. I've said that many standardized tools are available, okay? And researchers may use them, or if appropriate standardized tool is not available, then the researcher can develop them. And for developing and standardizing the tool, you have to follow the steps. See, when you are cooking, for cooking, you follow the steps. When you make halwa, steps are different. When you make kheer, the steps are different. Like this, you know. So different steps are, what are the steps? Step number one is giving operational definition. I will explain what exactly is the meaning of an operational definition. The second step is, once you have given the operational definition, then as a researcher, you should be able to write the item. See, item is a technical word which you can use for all tools. It can be used for scale. It can be used for questionnaire. It can be used for inventory. It can be used for test. It can be used for observation schedule for interview. So item is a word which is a technical word, and it can be used in any tool you like, no problem. Whether it is a standardized tool or it's not a standardized tool, so you have to write item. And the third step is initial tryout. This is important. And the initial tryout will be done on three. Number one is experts. I will explain it. Number two is individual tryout. And number three is the group tryout. The main purpose of the initial tryout is to know whether the items which you have written, they are appropriate or not. And then these items are able to differentiate amongst the people or not. Okay. So therefore, the item analysis is also to be done here only on the basis of group tryout, but I will explain once again. The third step is, which is a final step, and it is for establishing the reliability, establishing the validity, and establishing the norms. So these are the four steps which the researcher who is interested in developing his or her own tool, and further he or she wants to standardize it. So for development and standardization, these are the four tools you have, four steps you have to use. And each step has a particular activity that as a researcher you have to undertake. Now I'll go and I'll try to explain each and every step. But in today's one, I think go only up to the step number 3, which is initial tryout. And I think I will complete the up to individual tryout. Okay, let us see. Now, first step is a operational definition. Now, tool is developed for assessing the variable. If you want to develop a tool for anxiety, so your tool must assess the anxiety. But anxiety cannot be assessed in total. Some portion of the anxiety you can assess. That is where that your tool will only assess the partial. It will not give the complete information. If you want to develop a tool for personality, so the variable is personality. If you want to develop a tool for reasoning, then variable is reasoning. If you develop a tool for achievement in physics test, so therefore the variable is achievement in physics. Some people say achievement test in physics. Please understand, achievement test in physics or achievement in physics test. You know, sometime when you keep on reading something which is not technically correct, but since it appears number of times, so you think it is correct. So sometime consistency is there in writing, and sometime it may mislead you. So you have to be careful when you read it again and think and see whether it is a correct name or not. I say again, achievement test in physics or achievement in physics test, which one is appropriate? Think about it. Now, each variable can be defined in several ways, because in social science, there cannot be only one and only one definition. In pure science, if you have to define force, everyone defined exactly the same way, because there the force has been conceptualized and everyone understand it is same way. If it is a kinetic energy, everyone will understand it in the same way. But in social sciences, that doesn't happen. When you say self-confidence, I understand in some other way. The job satisfaction, you understand in your own way. I understand in my own way. Interest, you know, it's all different. So therefore, this is very important that each variable in social science can have multiple definitions. So the researcher has to give operational definition of the variable. What is the meaning of the operational definition? Operational definition means the researcher is able to observe and assess. If you define a particular variable in such a way so that the researcher can observe and can assess, then that definition will become the operational definition of that particular variable. So it describes exactly what the variable is and how it is to be assessed within the context of the study. This I have said. You as a researcher have to define anxiety the way you want to understand it. or the way you want to study it. I can take anxiety in a different fashion and I can study that. So in the context of the study. So the operational definition is clear, concise, and detailed. The quality and comprehensiveness of the tool depends upon the operational definition. If you expand your operational definition, the comprehensiveness will expand. If you reduce your operational definition, then the comprehensiveness will reduce. For example, if it is adjustment, if I want to study the school adjustment, the home adjustment, and the peer adjustment, then my tool will only have the items related to these three. So this is how I am giving an operational definition of that adjustment. Somebody else may say it is school, peer, class, society. So he is adding. So therefore, it depends upon how many dimensions of that variable you want to cover in that particular tool. You know, there are many personality, the scales are there, and each personality scale will have different dimension, different components. And there can be many operational definition of the variable, whatever variable you have, reasoning, you can have as many definitions as you like. Intelligence, you can have as many definitions as you like. And the operational definition will help in interpretation of the results. Yes, because whatever is your operational definition, your item will be written keeping in mind the operational definition. So your all item will help you to assess whatever is reflected by your operational definition. And so, at the time of interpretation, it will help us. I am giving an example. The researcher may define sleep deprivation as he is having a variable. The variable is a sleep deprivation, and he says a person is having a sleep deprivation if he gets less than 7 hours of sleep in the night. If you ask me how many hours did you sleep in the night, if I say 4 hours, then you can say you have a sleep deprivation. If somebody tells that I have 8 hours, that means you do not have a sleep deprivation. So that is why, how you have defined the word, and therefore when you have to correct the data, this is how it will help you in collecting the data, finding out those people who have the sleep deprivation and who does not have the sleep deprivation. If I say driving performance is the variable, how do I define? I define, say, as how well a participant does on a driving test. I may give a driving test and I may try to find out what different mistakes the person is doing. If he is doing more mistakes, then I'll say your performance is not good. So therefore, this is how I define driving performance. You can define your driving, the number of accidents the person had during this period of the driving. The more the accidents, the bad is the driver driving. So that means he doesn't have the confidence. He doesn't have the proper, say, competency to drive. So you can define in any way. If I say higher and mental ability in science, how do I define? Okay, higher mental ability in science is the product resulting from application, analysis, synthesis, and evaluation in science. Please understand. So since I have taken these four aspects, application, analysis, synthesis, and evaluation, so I will take some information, concept from science, and then I will try to write questions in such a way where the application aspect is assessed, where the analysis aspect is assessed, and where the synthesis aspect and evaluation aspects are assessed. So if you take this particular tool and if you want to use it, then you know that this tool only assessed these four aspects, and that is what he has called it higher mental ability. Somebody may define a higher mental ability in a very different fashion. Say, I may define a higher mental ability in physics is one who can solve 10 numericals in 5 minutes. So I give 10 numericals and I give 5 minutes, and then I try to find out whether the response is correct or response is wrong. You know, so you can define in your own way, and then accordingly you can develop, and that is what the operational definition. So operational definition will help the researcher in observing, and anything which you can observe, you can assess. Say there are many behaviors of the human being. It's very, very difficult to observe. Many a times we suppress many of our behaviors. I am angry, but I may give a smile, and smiling may indicate that I am happy, but it does not mean I am happy. I might be angry. You must have seen there are many people who have such a face. It's a smiling face. Even if they are on the deathbed, still they smile. But that does not mean that the person is happy. The person is not having a pain. So these are some of the behaviors, especially in psychology, very difficult to predict on the basis of the behavior, because the behavior may reflect something else, and inside something else might be going. But nevertheless, try to define the way you want to define. And the operational definition which the researcher will give, it will determine the quality of the tool. And for getting the operational definition, you as a researcher can refer to different dictionaries. If it is a word which is from psychology, you can see the dictionary of psychology. If there is a word from computer science, so there is a dictionary of computer science. If there is a word from education, there is a dictionary of education. So like this, there is a medical dictionary. So there are different dictionaries. So this is the one that you take a word and try to see how people define. Second is, there might be books where the definition of some of the words are given. You can take those definitions. You can take some of the definitions. These days, you can find online also. if you use Google or any other platform, you can find out the definition of different words given by different people. Now, if you look at all these definitions, you may find some commonness among these, but there might be some differences. So you as a researcher has to think, do you want to take one definition out of these, or do you want to give your own definition after understanding the definition given by so many people? Now, if you decide to write your own definition, then you must write it in such a way so that it can be observed and therefore it can be measured. This is observable and measurable, very important. Now, in the operational definitions, some of the points which you have to keep in the mind is, number one, identify the characteristics of the interest. Whatever the variable that you are taking, in that, which characteristics is very important for you. Another researcher has to decide whether you want to use test or scale or inventory for the assessment. I have given you the name of some of the variables, and if those variables you want to have in your research, for example, reasoning. So for reasoning, you cannot have a scale. For reasoning, you cannot have an inventory. For reasoning, you have to have the test only. So therefore, you should know for which variable the test is appropriate, for which variable the scale is appropriate, and for which variable the inventory is appropriate. And so operational definition should be written so that it can be used in different stages of the tool development. This I will, when I proceed further, I will highlight that here, when you are writing the items have to be written keeping in mind the operational definition, because operational definition will give the different aspects of the variable in which you are interested. So therefore, keeping in mind the operational definition at the time of writing the item is very, very useful and important. It is essential to test the operational definition before it is used. You know, whatever the operation, do not have an operational definition which you cannot use it. There might be some very, very abstract words which you are using, and those abstract words means you cannot really find out whether that particular behavior is occurring or it is not occurring. So therefore, your operational definition has to be in those words, or using or identifying those characteristics, or highlighting those attributes which can be observed. That is important. You know, many a times you look at the face of the person, and if it is red, now you know that means this particular person is not normal now. Because when the face is red, either he is excited or he is very angry. Now, whether it is angry or excited, now, these are the two information you are getting while looking at the face of the person. A person is walking, very fast in the room. He's just walking from one corner to another corner. That particular behavior may indicate that either he is stressed or he is confronted with some problem and is trying to find the solution. You know, so these behaviors, you as a researcher has to articulate and relate and see. So the operational definition part, I do not know how much you have understood, but this is important. And let me tell you, dear friends, if you are not able to give the definition, you can ask some of the experts from the field. And those experts, they can give the definition. And after collecting the definition given by different people and given in different books, you can analyze and have your own definition. Start doing this exercise at home. Think of a word, see the dictionary, find out the meaning, and think what can be your own definition. Because some of you might not have done this exercise, so now you can do it. The more you do such type of exercise, more expert or expertise you develop in giving the operational definition. Okay? All right. Now, the second step, once you have given the operational definition of the variable for which you want to develop that particular tool, the second step is important, is item writing. You have to write the item. Now, when you are writing the item, then this item writing is not very easy. It is really very difficult. But nevertheless, you have to do it. So item is a technical word, which, as I have said, that in place of question or in place of statement, I will be most of the time using a word item, because it can fit in all tools, including your scale, including your schedule, including your questionnaire or test, whatever it is. This I have said, that sometimes people use questionnaire in case of a test. Okay? Statement in the scale and list in the inventory. Now, in fact, you cannot use questionnaire as a word, neither for test, nor for scale, and nor for inventory. In reality, this question, when you are saying, sometimes you use it in the test, that how many questions were there in your exam test of physics? You say 5 questions. Okay, so question, sometimes you use in case of a test, statement you use in case of a scale, and list you use in case of inventory. And if you don't want to use question, don't want to use statement, and don't want to use list, you can use item. So that is why it's always better to use one word which fits everywhere. But if you are developing a test and you want to use the word questionnaire, question, perfectly correct. If you are developing an inventory, then you have to use the word list, no problem. If you are developing a scale, you can use the word statement. But if you don't want to use, if you don't remember, then better to use the word item. The quality of the response of an individual, it depends on the structure of the item, the language of the item. You know, many a times you ask someone in such a way, the other person is not able to give the response because he has not understood what you want. So that is what is more, the structure of that particular item is very, very important. Whenever you are writing the item, there are some points which you must keep in the mind. Whether you are writing item for a test or for a scale or for an inventory, you have to keep these points. See, you have to write items even for observation schedule, even for interview schedule, and even for questionnaire. Okay, so therefore, the points which now I am going to tell you, these points you have to keep in the mind whenever you are writing an item either for a test or a scale or an inventory or a schedule or an interview schedule or a questionnaire. The points have to be kept in the mind because they are applicable everywhere. So one important is the grammar, the use of the, because you will be writing a sentence. And when you are writing a sentence, the grammar is very important. And lot of people, when they write a sentence, grammatically, the sentence is wrong. And grammatically, if it is wrong, then you know whatever the response that you are getting from that particular person will also be the wrong. So the grammar aspect, the punctuation marks, very important. The spelling, very important. And the whatever the spelling that you are writing, the consistency in this spelling. This is important. Say, when you write, generalize, sometime we use word Z as sometime we use word S. So keep on using one word. Say analyze. Sometime I use word Z, sometime I use word S. So there must be consistency. Now whatever the word that you are using, it has to be consistently used so that the responder is not confused. So the first important point is the grammar, the punctuation marks, and the spellings. Whatever you are writing, there has to be a consistency in the spellings. Another is express the item as precisely. Precision is very important. The clearly and simply. Do not write the item which becomes a complex item. Try to be precise, very clear, and it has to be as simple as not impossible. The language which you have to use, it must be of the members of your target group. If you are taking the people from South, and if they are well versed with English, very fine. Otherwise, if they are Tamil people, Malayalam people, things of that variety, so you have to write in their own language. If you go to West Bengal, Bengali, or sometimes people write in English as well as another one. If you go to Haryana, maybe English and Hindi will be all right. Because all Hindi may not work. So therefore, the language part is very important and it has to be such so that it fits to that particular. If your target group is illiterate, then exactly how the data will be, how this tool will be administered, I'll tell you later on. But the important is the words which you will be using it, I think it is coming. The words which you will be using, it must be such that it from the background of the people. there are many words which in one particular place it is different, it gives a different meaning. But if you take that word in the place to which it belongs, it gives a different meaning. So background of the target group you have to keep in mind, whether they belong to urban area or they belong to the rural area. Because if they belong to urban area and rural area, their vocabulary will be very different, their pronunciation will be very different, etc. So that you have to keep in the mind. You have to see whether your people, the target group, whether they belong to the educated family or an illiterate family, whether their parents are working, the government, or things of that variety. So that is important. Then another is that you cannot write hundreds of items because it takes a lot of time. So longer the tool, the less chances of getting the reliable responses. So you have to see that you have to minimize the number of the items so that the examinee is not able to devote more time unnecessarily in reading. Instead of that, he should devote more time in giving the as reliable as not impossible the responses. So the reading time on the item, that is why sometimes you don't write a very long items, you write short items. Okay, so that is important. The vocabulary, I have said just a few seconds before, the vocabulary must be consistent with the examinee's level of understanding. You use those words which the member of your target group is able to understand it. And that is where I said some words are more prominent in urban area and some words are more prominent in the rural area. So you have to see whether you want to use this particular tool on urban people or rural people, etc., or educated or uneducated. Each item must focus on a single dimension. This is very important. Sometimes the people, one particular item has got two things. For example, if I say development of tone is technical and difficult. Now here I am saying technical and difficult. Now when the person is giving a response, whether he is giving response for both the for both these things or only one. So such item where you have two or more than two, when you have this, they are called double barreled items. So you should not have the items which reflect more than one dimension or more than one component or more than one meaning. It should give only one and only one meaning to all people. This is important. Many times we have a tendency to take some of the sentences from the books. Do not do this. So do not take item verbatim from any textbook. Okay? Because when you are developing a tool for the stress, maybe you have read something either in the magazine or in some books about the stress, and there is a one sentence and you think it is appropriate and you use it as it is. No, don't do that. You restructure, you write it in your own words so that it is appropriate for your tool. Another is that the instructions have to be given. Because if the instructions are not very clear to the responder, then whatever the responses the person is giving, these responses will not be the reliable one because he has not understood your instructions. So instructions must be as clear as not impossible. Your instructions must give information about if there are different dimensions, then whether there is a time limit, how the responses have to be given, okay, whether he has to write his own response or he has to select from the alternatives which you have given, okay, or if you are giving a time frame or there is no time limit, you take your own time, you know, and then you must mention one important thing, that your responses will be kept confidential and used only for research purpose. This has to be there. And if it is so, then to make it more objective, many a times we do not ask the responder to write the name. Okay? We need not, if you want to ask to write the class, to write the name of the school, you can, otherwise you may not. You know, you have to write these things in such a way so that whatever the responses you are expecting, they are the most reliable and objective responses. We must not use the vague words. For example, sometime, come before sunset. What the meaning before sunset means what? So there might be some of the words which are the vague words. They may not give the same meaning to different people. The people, they try to understand the word the way they want to understand it. Sometime the two people, they fight, not because there is something, because the whatever he has said, the other person has understood it in a very different fashion. And why that has happened? Because of the words which he has used, they are vague words. Vague words are those which can give different meaning to different people. Okay, do not try to use it. Another is, use multiple choice type items to assess the higher level of thinking. If you want to have the higher level of thinking, then it is advisable that you can use multiple choice type item, or you can use multiple discriminatory type items, or you can use multiple answers type item. But these two which I have said, which I have developed, many of the people, they don't know and they do not understand. Okay, so these are some of the points which you have to keep in the mind. And the other points are that if you are developing a scale, I have seen many scales where majority of the items are positively worded. And if majority of items are positively worded, you cannot expect the net result which is not positive. This should not happen. So therefore, to take care of such a problem, what you have to do is, if you are writing 20 items, out of 20, 10 must be positively worded and 10 must be negatively worded. If it is so, then sometime a neutral position can come. Otherwise, if majority items are negatively worded, your net result will be negative type. It is towards the negative aspect of that variable. If majority are positively worded, that net result will be positive. So therefore, in order to take care of this, you have to write both the positive as well as the negative items, and they must be the same number. So if you have 43 items, then you should either write 44 items or you should write 42 items. So that 50-50% you can do it. Another important thing I like to tell you here is, because in the scale, many a times the person may give the response without reading the item. Sometimes there is a response set that if it is strongly agree, agree, undecided, disagree, strongly disagree, you can find the randomness in the responses many a times. Or sometimes you can find the other trend in the responses. That indicates that the person has not read the items and he is giving the response without reading it. Then what is the way out? I have a way out that if I'm writing the 20 items, then one item I will write in between that I am not giving the responses. Okay? Or I am dead. Such items, you can put them anywhere. Don't put it in the beginning, don't put it at the end, put it somewhere in the middle. And if you find, if the person has written, you have written, I am dead. And he has said strongly agree. So that means he has not read the item and therefore he is giving responses without reading the item. And this particular response sheet can be discarded. Now such items are called filler items. So they will help you to decide whether you are getting the genuine responses or you are not getting the genuine responses. Now this particular item is not to be used for the scoring purpose, because you have used this item just to discriminate between the genuine responses and the non-genuine responses. Try to use this and see the quality of the responses, whether it improves or it does not improve. Now, when you are developing a scale, the humor you should try to avoid. In test, you cannot use humor. But in scale, yes, it's possible. Many times you can use humor. So should not use humor. In the test, make sure there is only one and only one correct answer if it is a multiple choice. If it is a multiple discriminatory type item, there are also one and only one correct answer. But if it is multiple answers type, there may be more than one. But this people don't know. So most of you will develop a test where only one correct answer will be there. So you write the item so that other alternatives are the distractors. If for one particular item, you are giving five choices, out of five, only one is correct. So remaining four must act as a distractors. Why distractors? Because they distract you, and if you are very sure, you will not get distracted, but if you are not sure, you get distracted. So that's what you should do. Avoid the jargons. Don't use jargons and don't take the book language. Eliminate irrelevant sources of difficulty. See, if you are writing a item for the comprehension test, then you can use difficult words. But if you are writing an item for the scale, then why should you use the difficult words? Because the purpose is not to assess the language competence. If your purpose is to assess the language competence, then you can use difficult words, no doubt about it. Otherwise, avoid the use of the difficult words. Try to use simple words. Try to use those words which give one and only one meaning in that particular sentence to all people. Another is that because you are developing a tool which you want to standardize, and if that has to be done, then you must write the double the number required. If you want 20 items, you must write 40 items. And if some of you have experience in item writing, then you know it is difficult to write 20 items. How will you write 40 items? But nevertheless, you have to make efforts, do it, try, take other people's help. So you have to write double. Double does not mean exactly double, but whatever the number you want to have, you have to have more than that. If you want 20 items, you should take at least not 40, at least 35, at least 30 items. Why? Because some of the items, they will be rejected at different points of time. When we go to the initial tryout, you'll find that some items are rejected at some point, some are there. So therefore, that is the one. So that's what exactly you have to understand. Another is when you are giving the instructions, which is very important, because the quality of the responses will depend to a great extent on the instruction that you are giving. So instructions must include what the tool intends to assess, how to give response, whether there is a time limit or no time limit, how exactly the scoring procedure has to be done, that one correct answer will get 1 mark or one correct answer will get 2 marks or something like that. If you cannot do it, don't worry. In some of the items, some of the tools, you may not be able to do this, but if possible, you do it. And clear instruction will help the subject in giving the genuine responses. This I have said. And therefore, it will improve the validity and the reliability of the tool. I'm sure that some of you might have understood the step number one, that is operational definition. The step number two, where you have to write the item. And your item writing cannot be before you give the operational definition. So the sequence is, first you have to give the operational definition, and on the basis of the operational definition, you have to write the items. And once you have written the items, then and only then the tryout can take place. This tryout is of two types. One is called an initial tryout. And the objective of the initial tryout, number one is the suitability of the language. Whatever the words you are writing, whatever the sentences you are writing, whether they are appropriate to the target group or not. So suitability of the language is very important. And it is for item analysis. The extent to which the items are able to assess the variable under the study, this is very important. Whether whatever the items that you are trying to write, whether it really can assess. So initial tryout will help you to find out that, and who will tell you this, whether the item will be able to assess what you want to assess. This will be given only by the experts. I will come to that. So for initial tryout is for three things: item analysis, the suitability of the items, and to what extent the item assesses what you want to assess. The final tryout is only for establishing the reliability, the validity, and the norms. These are the one. Now, we first go to the initial tryout. This initial tryout is done at a three levels. Number one is expert tryout. Number two is individual tryout. And number three is group tryout. These are the three tryouts exactly in the same sequence. First, it has to be expert tryout. Next, it has to be individual tryout. And last, it has to be the group tryout. Now, the expert tryout and individual tryout will help in knowing the suitability of the language. Expert, you know, the person who has either developed a tool for that particular variable, or he is an expert of that particular field in which the variable belongs, or to which the variable belongs. Okay. And the data from the expert tryout will help in understanding the extent to which the items are able to assess the variable. When I will explain how it is to be done, so you just wait. The expert tryout. See, it is very difficult to find the larger number of the expert and to say who is an expert. Can you call me as an expert? Somebody will say yes, and somebody may say no. So it's sometimes difficult to say who is an expert, because there is no list of the experts. But I'll tell you, see, an expert, as I said a few seconds before, an expert is one who has carried out research around that particular variable, or a person who has developed a tool for that particular variable. That person will be called an expert. But dear friends, there are no lists. You cannot have a list as you can have the list of institutions. but list of experts is never there. So therefore, if you want to develop the tool for your PhD, then your guide can help you, or some other teacher can help you to locate, to find out some of the experts. Some of them might be around you where your institution is there. There might be other institutes, or you may get people from outside the country also these days, because you can contact them through emails, etc. So, but there is nothing like a list. This I have said, an expert is one who has developed the tool for the variable under study, or who is an expert in the research methodology, especially tool development. The number of experts cannot be large. You cannot say 1,000 experts. No, it's not possible. So number will be very small. So normally, when you have to try it out on experts, you can take around 15 experts or around 10 experts. But this 10 and 15 is not the limit. If you can get 16 experts, you can take 16. But I'm sure you cannot get 50 experts. It's not possible. Yes, 15, 16, okay, fine. But if you can get 100 experts, I'm quite doubtful you will get so many experts. It's not possible. So normally people take 10 to 15 experts. So after having identified the experts, you have to take their consent, whether they are ready to help you to go through your tool, your items, and help you in refining the items. This has to be done, ensure. If you approach an expert, he's an expert, but he shows his inability to help you out, so it's of no use, you can't take him. So therefore, it's always better to approach them to take their consent. Okay. Once you receive the consent, then you must give the tool to the expert. And when you are giving the tool to the expert, then along with the tool, you should give the operational definition, because each item has to be assessed in the context of the operational definition. As operational definition changes, the item will also change. So give this thing. Also give the name of the dimensions or name of the components. Some people say dimensions, some people say components, some people say elements, whatever you like. And you must give the language in which it is to be.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for such an informative session. It was a very detailed explanation of each and every single topic we covered today. So thank you again. Now we will go ahead and take some time for question answers now. Our participants have asked many questions. So let's start it. So here.
Hello, organizers, Gupta, hello, hello.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Anchor.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir. We are able to hear you.
Okay. Sorry, sir. So, because of power failure, so I'm sorry for that. Okay. So now I'm. So I was just trying to explain you this point. The initial tryout, that after having the consent, okay, then, and you have to give operational definition to the expert. You have to give the name of the dimensions or the components, then the language in which it is written. Hello. Ha ha, theek hai. ठीक है. नाउ देन यू हैव टू गिव द डायमेंशन वाइज आइटम्स बिकॉज द एक्सपर्ट डज नॉट नो दैट फर्स्ट आइटम बिलोंग्स टू विच डायमेंशन, द सेकेंड आइटम बिलोंग्स टू विच डायमेंशन. इफ यू हैव रिटन 40 आइटम्स then which items belong to which particular dimension, that you have to give. And if you do not give this thing, then the expert will not be able to judge and will not be able to tell you whether this item can assess this dimension or not, whether this item is related to this dimension or not. So it is very, very important, because for one particular dimension you might have written more number of the items. So the expert must know which item belongs to which dimension. Okay. And if suppose you are now sending it by post, then very important that when you are sending the tool in an envelope, in that envelope along with your tool, you should put one more envelope, and on that particular envelope you must write your address and you must put stamps. Because why? The expert should pay for you. If you are sending your tool through mail, email, then there is no need. But still there might be situation where you are not able to have the mail of the experts and you have to send it by post, then self-addressed and stamped envelope must be accompanied with it. This is important, dear friends. And some of the experts, they may send their responses fast, but there might be some of the expert, because they are the real expert, so they do not have time. So you have to really follow them. You have to be in contact with them, request them many a times. Sometime the expert will say, I'm sorry, I don't have time, I will not be able to do. Then you have no choice. You say, sorry, okay, find out another one. That's what you have to do, but you must follow it up. This is a very important thing. This I have said, those who do not respond, then you need to follow them up. Continue following the expert till you get the observation from majority of the people. Now this word majority is a vague word. What is the meaning of majority? Out of 15, if 10 people they give, is it a majority? Or if 7 people they are able to give, is it a majority? So please take your own decision. People write such words many a times. So out of 15, see how many people, how many experts have given their own observation. And whatever the observations you have got, now you have to analyze it, you have to see it. This is very important. So if you still want some more experts and you have got it and you can send the tool and you can, choice is yours, you can do it. Now, once you have got the observation of each and every expert, then you take the item number one and you see what is the observation of expert one, expert two, expert three. If 10 experts have given, then what are the observation of these 10 on item number one? This is very important. Now, if you find that majority of the expert, they have made or they have suggested no change in the item, then it means this item seems to be all right. You can go ahead with this particular item. But if they suggest you something, then you have to once again see this particular item in the light of the suggestion which the majority of these people are making, the experts are saying. And then you have to revise the item in the light of the suggestions. So if majority do not suggest, then it is okay. If they say yes, many a times, it has come through experience, many a times, even if one expert says that you should change this item like this. Now, since only one expert is saying, now it is up to the person who is developing a tool, you take your own decision and see whether you should modify the item in the light of the suggestion which only one expert is given. It happens many a times that some of the experts might be very, very critical and the number is not too large. Such type of people are very less in number. So even one person, if he is suggesting you something, see it carefully, understand it, and if you also agree, then please modify the items as suggested. So on the basis of the expert's tryout, some of the items might be dropped or some of the items might be modified. Or it is possible that some experts may write one or two items. So therefore, now if you started with 40 items, now you may not have all 40 items. You may have less than 40 items because some of the items have been rejected by the expert, either because of the language or because that item does not have a capacity to assess what exactly you want to assess. So therefore, that has to be done. Now, whatever the suggestions are there, you have to modify these modification of this are suggested to the researcher. So researcher has to modify the tool. And the modification has to be done in the light of the observations made by the experts or the suggestions made by the expert. Now, experts have also examined each item in the light of the operational definition. Please understand, this is very important. So that means they have established the content validity. Because when the items, the expert has said, yes, this item can assess this aspect of the variable. So if they are agreeing, then it means it reflects upon the validity of the item. And therefore, you establish the content validity, because the experts are saying on the basis of the content of the item. So depending upon the content of the item, they are saying it. These items are all right and these items are not all right. Okay, so therefore, this content validity will be there, whatever the tool you develop, which you want to standardize, whether it is a test or a scale or a inventory. Because the question here, which you are developing or observation schedule which you are developing, that you are not going ahead with the experts try out. You don't give it to the expert. Now, once you have done the expert tryout and on the basis of the observation of the experts, you have modified the items, and now your items, whatever you have, now you are ready for what exactly is called an individual tryout. Individual tryout means you have to take people for whom you are developing the tool. And one person is taken at a time and you are trying out all the items by taking one person at a time, and that is why it is called individual tryout. Individual tryout is not very easy. It is time consuming. It is difficult in many aspects. So this I have said, whatever items that expert have said, okay, now they are ready for your individual tryout. The main purpose of the individual tryout is the item which are there, whether these items are suitable or not. Now, suitability with respect to what? Suitability with respect to the language. The suitability with respect to the words which are used in that particular one, etc., etc. So that's what you have to do. Now, it is done on individuals belonging to that population on which it is to be used later on. If you are developing a reasoning test for the college students, then you have to take the people for individual tryout who are in the college, maybe first year, maybe second year, whatever you like. If you have for postgraduate, then you can take the postgraduate people from either the college or the university. So that's the population, so you can take that. And when you are taking, you have to select these people randomly. Randomly means anyone who is there, you just go, and if he is able to help you out, then you can take that. Normally, the individual tryout which you have to do, you cannot take hundreds of students. If you take hundreds, if on one particular person, if you are devoting half an hour to try it out individually, then if you have to do the individual tryout on 100, you need 50 hours. And if it 1 hour, if one day you take, you do it for 5 hours, which is very tough, you need 10 days. So please understand, that is why you cannot take a large number of the people for the individual tryout. So individual tryout, normally people take up to, see the number which I am saying, don't stick to it. If you want to take 26, you can take. If you want to take 18, you can take, no problem at all. But do not take too less number and do not take too large number, because the main purpose is only to find out the suitability of the items with respect to the language. That is the words which you are using, the sentence construction which you have done, etc., etc. It is time consuming, because you have to try it out on one student at a time, one subject at a time, one person at a time. So on a one particular day, it is very difficult to work on a day not more than 3 or 4 individuals are taken. It's very, very difficult. Okay, so first of all, what you have to do is you establish the rapport with the person, the student, the target group, members of the target group when you are taking. So tell who you are, what you are doing, things of that variety. And then you have to give the instruction to the person. Let him read the instruction. And once he has finished reading the instruction, then you as a tool developer can ask, is it all right? Or do you think there is a particular word which is confusing? Or do you think you want me to replace any word which is difficult for you? If the person tells you, yes, this word is difficult, then immediately you note down that word which is difficult and you tell him in place of that word another word. So you have to think immediately. So please understand, you have to have a good vocabulary with you. Okay? With you means not dictionary in hand, in your mind. So you note it down and keep it. Now once the instruction is okay, then you give the one item and at a time and let him read that particular item, and in case there is any problem in that particular item, first he has read the instruction, now he is given one item, he reads it, and if there is a problem, then you should modify then and there. This is important. Now on the basis of this individual tryout, the modifications may be done. Because if there are some items which have to be dropped because of the individual tryout, you see, the first of all, you did the expert tryout. So some items were rejected by the expert. Experts might have added few items, but ultimately your number of items after the expert tryout were not 40, they were less than 40. Now those items, if you take it further to the individual tryout, some items will be discarded on the basis of the individual tryout. So the individual tryout and the expert tryout will judge each and every item on the basis of their language, because the expert is also judging it and individual is also judging it. Okay, and on the basis of whether the item is able to assess or not, this is only given by the expert. The student may not be able to say this thing. Student is only for the language part. So some item might be replaced with a new item, that is all right. Now, whatever the items are there, hello. Whatever the items are there, now these items you should collect and you arrange it in a particular fashion, and now you will be ready for the group tryout. So therefore, the next, what we have to do is, we have to do the group tryout. And this group tryout, I will be taking it tomorrow. So for today, it is only up to this particular point. So any question any one of you wants to ask, you're most welcome. And now it is over to the host. Please go ahead.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for such an informative session. And it was a very detailed explanation of each and every single topic we covered today. So thank you again. Now we will go ahead and take some time for question answers now. Our participants have asked many questions. So let's start it. So here is our first question. One of the participants has asked, can we go with either validity or reliability in educational research, or both are required? I repeat, can we go with either validity or reliability in educational research, or both are required? Over to you, sir.
In educational research, whenever a tool is standardized, you have to develop the reliability, establish the reliability as well as validity. But I like to put a question, because see, if a tool is valid, then it has to be reliable. If it is so, then why there are methods of establishing reliability? Now I will request the participants to think about the answer and come tomorrow, and I will tell you the answer. And anchor, please write it down in your copy, and tomorrow you should ask me this question. Okay, fine. Okay. So why do we establish the reliability? This is important. Next.
So the next question is, sometimes we feel that a tool is too long and we do not able to collect the data accordingly. So is there any measure to reduce the questionnaire?
My dear participants, I had said, when you are writing the items, the number of the items to be written, you have to take care of that. Because in one particular research, with the help of one particular tool, it is not possible to collect each and every to it. So as a researcher, you have to limit yourself. So therefore, you have to definitely say, through this tool, I'm going to assess only this aspect of that variable. So therefore, number of the items will be reduced accordingly. It has of the operational definition. Next question.
Okay, sir. So next question is, how to make a tool on conception and perception of sustainable development and eco-pedagogy using UNESCO toolkit? Kindly elaborate it, sir.
Now, the question absolutely is too vague. Because in this question, there are many variables, so it is very difficult to get what exactly the question is. The person is asking question related to which one? Is it, are they asking that UNESCO has developed a kit? And if it is a kit may have only one tool, but may have many tools. Whether the person is asking that, person is asking if they have to develop the tool, I don't know. So the question is vague. If you are asking that the UNESCO has developed a kit, and if you want to use that particular kit, then you as a researcher must decide whether you should use all the tools which are available in, or some of the tools are not relevant to your study, so you need not to use it. And the kit which you has developed, is it standardized or is it not standardized? If it is standardized, is it standardized on the population of your study? Whether it was standardized in India, or is it standardized outside? There are many questions which the person has to think, ask, get answer, and then decide whether the UNESCO kit can be used or it needs to be modified. Many a times, the tools developed in other countries cannot be used as it is. Of differences in culture, difference in our tradition, difference in our even education system, and many other things. Over to you.
Okay, sir. So one of the participants have asked, if our questionnaire is on Likert type, then scoring would be measured in quantitative way or not?
Now, the question itself is wrong. Please understand, I told you that you cannot use the word questionnaire. If it is a questionnaire, then questionnaire cannot have a scale. This is the most important drawbacks of our writers. Many of the books in the research methodology, they include scales in questionnaire, which is technically incorrect. Please understand, scale is a scale and questionnaire is not a scale. You cannot as a part scale as a part of questionnaire. This is the first comment. So therefore, the question is here. Now, if you have the quantitative, the answer is yes. Because you know that if you have a positive item and if you have strongly agree, undecided, strongly disagree, then you can assign weightages. And when you are assigning weightages, weightages must be such in, say, we say 4, 3, 2, the difference of 1. If you like, you can keep this difference as half, you can keep this difference as 2, and once you keep this difference, then it is equal intervals, and there are 0. A fixed zero. Your data. Next
question. Okay, so may I ask the next question? Hello, sir, are you hearing me? Sir, no. Summarize kar do. Question to puch liye.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello. Hello.
Priti, yes, light
sir.
Again.
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir.
Sorry, sir. I'm not able to hear you.
I'm so sorry. There was a power cut. Now power has come. Okay. You can go ahead.
So we can go ahead with a few questions are left. Okay,
yes.
Sir. Okay, sir. Okay, participants, sorry for a short technical disturbance. So we are again with our question answer round. And the question, one of the participants have asked, so when we use a standardized tool in a population, we are not able to get satisfactory results. And when we again do this, implement the standardized tool on the same population, we again get the different result. So how can we say which results are reliable?
Now, please understand. The question says, when we use standardized tool, see, beforehand you cannot expect that this will be the result. That is wrong. Let me tell you, dear friend, if you have a tool, and if it is a standardized tool, and if you population that tool, from that population, then whatever will be the result, you cannot say that this is a correct or this is incorrect, because to say correct and incorrect and satisfactory and not satisfactory, there is nothing like that in. In the research, I cannot say I am satisfied. I cannot say I am not satisfied. I only have to systematically, and whatever will be the data, I analyze it properly, and whatever will be the result, I have to accept it as it is. I cannot say that I am not satisfied. I am not satisfied. So this is number one. Number two, if data from the same member again and again, it is possible that responses will change. Why the responses will change? Because when you are administering the tool, at what time the tool was administered, what was the mental status of that particular person, so therefore it may that same tool may give a different result. When you are establishing reliability, then you know that different methods of establishing reliability is there, and you have that. So therefore you have, this is very natural that administer the responses are different, and you cannot say that I am satisfied, I'm not satisfied, because there is no standard answer. So in social sciences, whatever the data you have and whatever the result you get, you cannot say this result is correct or this result is incorrect. So you cannot say I'm satisfied or I'm not satisfied. If systematically these words satisfaction, unsatisfaction, words never be used as far as the next question.
So the next question is, the one of the participant writes, so I have to write flexibility as an operational definition. Then what are things I have to mention in the same?
Now, I will request the person who had said this thing, he or she must write the operational definition for flexibility first, show it to me, then I will tell whether it is all right or not. Because if I give the definition, then the person will not understand. So you can give my email address to this person and ask to send me this particular definition. I'll definitely immediately respond to it. Next question.
The next question is, explain difference between achievement test of physics or achievement of physics test.
Now, please see, when you say achievement in physics test, so that means you are assessing the achievement in physics. So the correct name is achievement in physics test. So the name of the tool should come afterwards. If it is a reaction towards ETV program scale, I cannot say reaction scale towards. This is wrong. So you have to understand these words in this particular fashion. So you cannot say achievement test of physics. No, it's not achievement test of physics. It is achievement in physics test. So you are using test to assess the achievement of the student in physics. So that is the correct one. Next question.
Okay, sir. The next participant have asked, if my research is of analytical type, then how can questionnaire be standardized?
No, my dear lady, the question is incorrect. And all researches are analytic in nature. Analytic means you have to analyze the data. And when you collect the data through the questionnaire, majority of your data will be qualitative in nature. And this qualitative data can be analyzed by using different techniques. One of the technique is called content analysis. Another technique is called meta-analysis. And another technique is called SWOT analysis. So therefore, the questionnaire can never be standardized, because for standardization, you have to calculate difficulty and discrimination index, for which you need quantity, you need numbers. Otherwise, difficulty level and discrimination index cannot be calculated. And for questionnaire, we cannot do it, so it cannot be standardized. Next question.
So this will be this will be the last question. One of the participants have asked, if we develop a tool and find the reliability, validity and norms, goes to try out process in 2 times, but collect the data from 600 samples in 1 district in tryout process, is it standardized or not?
My dear student, the participant, you should wait. I have only completed the very small portion of development and standardization of tool. When I come to the real aspect of it, establishing the reliability and validity and norms, then you should ask the question. Please hold on the question. Request to the participant. Next question.
So it was the last question. And now I just want to wrap up the program. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, sir, for giving us thank you so much, sir, and thank you all the participants for being a part of our program. It was a pleasure being with you all today. Catch you tomorrow at the same time. Till then, stay healthy. Bye.
I'm leaving now.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, participants. Thank you.